I'm Jim Turner, and welcome to dLife TV Online. It's going to be a great show in a new place. We'll be here Sundays at 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, with new shows about living your dLife. Every week, we'll be sharing insights, recipes from the dLife kitchen, stories about real people living and achieving with diabetes, and so much more. We're glad you're here. Now on with the show.
Big and intimidating place, but spend a little time with Yolanda Morales and her nephew Saint Butler and you'll feel right at home.
Saint is my niece's son, my mother's first great-grand.
They're both part of the same extended Puerto Rican family, but what really binds them together is their diabetes, a disease Yolanda's had for over 40 years.
I developed diabetes. I was 9 years old. We went to see our pediatrician. Maybe 2 days later, they called my mother that she had to bring me to the hospital right away because my glucose was 800.
It was 1968, and information about diabetes was hard to come by, especially since Yolanda's mother didn't speak English.
It was sad because she tried to understand, but she couldn't. She used to cry. She used to cry because she didn't know how to deal with diabetes at the time. So I went through some trouble with high glucose throughout the years.
As a result, Yolanda suffered some complications along the way.
At age 20, I had retinopathy of my eyes, which caused me to lose sight.
Finally, under the care of a new doctor, Yolanda regained most of her vision and has worked hard her whole life to stay a step ahead of her diabetes. Now she's married and has a grown son. But it was when Saint was born that an unexpected chapter in her life began.
He was a happy child at birth, but around the age of 6 months, 6 and a half, we noticed that he was always cranky. He was irritable. He was not a happy baby, would not sleep.
As fate would have it, Saint's babysitter had to go on vacation, and Yolanda offered to fill in.
I started observing him, and I had a gut feeling that something was going on. He didn't want to eat, but he wanted water.
Following her hunch, she used her own Lancing device and meter and pricked her little nephew's foot.
I checked his glucose, and Saint's glucose was 600.
Saint was rushed to the hospital, where he was diagnosed with type 1 diabetes. Ever since, Yolanda's been his after-school and summertime caregiver.
I knew that working together as a family and knowing more and the things that I know more about studies with diabetes and living with diabetes, he was going to be okay.
It was as if all of Yolanda's trials with diabetes suddenly had a purpose.
It made me feel like somebody needed me in the sense of dealing with diabetes. Sometimes I'm not feeling well, sometimes I want to stay home. And he gave me that strength to just get up and don't feel sorry or bad for myself. And he makes me live.
It feels like another member of me, like a duplicate of me, that has to do the same thing. It makes me feel happy, very happy.
My son has a role model to look up to. I don't understand what they go through on a daily basis, and I am very grateful to have my Aunt Yolanda around because she's taught me a lot on how to deal with his symptoms and his condition and how to understand him more.
155, Saint. When we go out to the supermarket, he knows how to look at the carb counts. He knows how to buy his foods. And that's something that is great because in the future he's gonna need that.
I count cars because so I can know how much insulin I need to get.
Remember we were talking about rice? White rice brings up our glucose because it has a lot of...
carbs?
Carbs.
I take care of my diabetes by making sure my glucose is okay and staying active and healthy so my sugar won't go really high.
Saint is blossoming. He's a solid student and has a rich life ahead of him, thanks in no small part to the mentoring and support his Aunt Yolanda has given him.
Okay. Do you know how many slices of apple you can have?
Four.
Good boy. It's like he says, nobody understands what we go through, Titi, with diabetes. I said, so you're right. Nobody knows, only us.
They have each other for life. They're related. They understand each other, and they make each other happy. And I just want him to know that he's a very special child, and I wouldn't change him for anyone in the world.
Hi, and welcome to the dLife Kitchen. I'm Michelle Nashan, and today we're gonna make a sugar-free dessert, a really great one, sugar-free cheesecake. Now, for those of us living with diabetes, we have to worry about sugar and carbohydrates in general, but not with this one because no sugar, very, very low in carbs, and delicious. So this is great whether you're living with diabetes or not. So let's get started. First, we're gonna make a really nice sponge with some egg whites here. Just a couple of twists from the salt mill. And then we're gonna beat these egg whites until they achieve a stiff peak. Now we're gonna transfer these into another mixing bowl because we're gonna do the second part of our sponge. Wipe the bowl out. Now in the bowl, we're gonna put some baking Splenda. So we take this Splenda for baking and the egg yolks. We start at a low speed and then we speed it up a little bit. And we beat the two of these together until they cream. So we're gonna thin it with just a little bit of the lemon juice first. And then we're going to add a little bit of this cheese, just a bit at a time. You wanna beat it until it's nearly smooth before you add more cheese. There we go. And now we can actually turn the speed of the mixer up and then beat it until it's nice, smooth, and fluffy. And that is where we need to be. And then we're gonna just take a little bit of the lightened sponge, a bit at a time, and basically pull the egg whites up through the sponge, the heavier sponge, so that we continue to lighten it. You don't want all of the egg whites perfectly incorporated. Just like this, that's how it should look. Now here, I have a springform pan, and I'm just gonna line it lightly with a little bit of grapeseed oil. And we're just gonna let the batter kind of fall into the pan. Instead of using a spatula to spread it around, I just give it a little bit of a shake. Now we're gonna take this into a 400 degree oven, and we're gonna bake it for 10 minutes at 400 degrees. After 10 minutes, we're gonna turn the oven down to 300 degrees, let it bake another 40 minutes, turn the oven off, and then let the cake stand at least 1 hour in the oven so that it cools very slowly. This prevents those really deep cracks from forming in the cheesecake. This is what it looks like when it's finished. This one's been baked properly, and you can see it has just a few cracks in the top, and that's okay. Now, I believe somebody invented toppings just to take care of the cracks in the top of cheesecake, and this is a good one. Here we have just some really good quality sour cream, and then I'm gonna add the sugar-free sweetener. And here I'm using a little bit of vanilla extract. Beat it till it's nice and smooth, and we're ready to go. I'm just gonna scoop some on top, just like this. And I'm gonna use an icing knife to just kind of spread it around, As you can see, I have magically engineered the amount of the sour cream to fit perfectly into the indentation in the top of the cheesecake. This is really an amazing, low-carb, sugar-free cheesecake, and I think it's going to be quite tasty. I'm going to go eat it right now. For this recipe and other great tips, visit us at the website at dlife.com/recipebox. I'm Michelle Nishan. Thanks for joining us in the dLife Kitchen.
It's rare when an episode of low blood sugar is actually funny, and Minnie won't find this funny, and my wife certainly didn't find it amusing. But one night in the middle of the night, she came in and she woke me up because I was soaking wet, clearly having an insulin reaction. And I was in the middle of this dream where to go anywhere in the world, all you had to do was think it and you'd go there. And I was thinking, oh, I'm in Egypt, I'm in Iowa, I'm on the moon, and boom, I would go there. And it was this beautiful realization that was gonna change the way we all did things. And my wife is waking me up saying, Jim, you have to drink this juice. And I said, Lynn, it's not about the juice. All you gotta do is think it, you go there, and you be there. And she said, please, just drink the juice. And I started drinking while I was talking, and it was all going down my neck and my chest and all over the bed. And she said, you're really scaring me. And then I just jumped up onto the bed, and I said, do you think it? You go there and you be there. And she said, shit, you're gonna wake our son. And I said, well, I should wake him. This is important. I said, Otto, get up. I got something really important to tell you. And I said, how simple do I have to make this? And then I did this front flip onto the bed. And then I went running through the house, totally naked, and I leaped, twisting sideways, landing in the bed, and I looked up at her and I said, what do you need to know?
Four continents, 30 cities, 32,000 miles. Nat and Kat, you have made amazing race history. To win the amazing race. And you have won the $1 million. Congratulations.
Back in her real life, Nat lives in the coastal city of Newport Beach, California. She's got a guy friend named Nate and a busy career as an MD specializing in pain management.
Hi, this is Dr. Strand.
Recently, Nat shared her story with dLife founder Howard Steinberg.
So during the race, did diabetes actually become the motivating factor for you that you have to get to the next level and you have to get through it because of the diabetes, not in spite of the diabetes?
I really wanted to show that you could do anything with diabetes. So when times were tough, it definitely did give me a little bit extra strength to draw upon. But in the moment to moment, I mean, as you know, diabetes is a huge pain. And, you know, there was moments where I was like, oh, I just want my pump to stop beeping, or I don't want to have to worry about a refill right now, or I don't have to worry about feeling extra tired because my blood sugar is high. But in the big picture, that strength and that desire to prove myself really gave me some extra spunk.
It makes you who you are, but at the same time, it's kind of, you have to drag it along with you.
Exactly.
Nat's been dragging her diabetes along since her diagnosis at age 12 in Scottsdale, Arizona. The Strand family was always drawn to outdoor life, and Nat and her brother Nick soaked it all in. But then the telltale symptoms began.
My first memory is driving on a road trip with my family and my dad saying, stop drinking so much, because we keep having to pull over to go to the bathroom, you know? And I remember kind of just being so thirsty, and I went to camp that summer. I came home and my parents took one look at me and knew something was wrong.
Despite her diagnosis, it's always been full speed ahead for Nat. These days, she balances the demands of her busy medical career with things like half marathons and extreme outdoor sports. But nothing could have completely prepared her for the amazing race.
I'm currently in probably the hardest situation for a type 1 diabetic on an insulin pump. The schedule's off, I don't know when I'm gonna eat.
3:37.
I knew that running the race as a diabetic was going to be a challenge, but I've kind of gotten crafty at learning how to work our schedule to make sure that I'm safe and that I can do everything I wanna do.
But despite her careful planning and undeniable superwoman status, the amazing race eventually plays on one of her deepest phobias, a major fear of heights.
What happened was we're in Norway.
Where's the next gondola?
We were taking this gondola up a pretty steep and very high mountainside. Now, I've watched the show enough to know that when you're taking a gondola up the side of a mountain in Norway, you're not coming down in the gondola most of the time.
We're just afraid of what might be waiting for us up top.
You're going down some other way that has to do with, you know, wings or cables or bungees.
Yes.
So I was really nervous.
Matt, you're fine. We're on a gondola.
We're just on a gondola right now. Don't take yourself off.
I don't know if everyone is this way, or if I'm just particularly sensitive to stress, but my blood sugar shoots through the roof with stress.
I think my nerves are making my blood sugar go up
a little bit high.
Fortunately, Nat and Kat had previously earned a free pass called a fast forward, allowing them to skip any sky-high stunts, at least for now.
Well, one question I get a lot is, well, production must have made some exceptions for you, right? And they did not. They don't make any exceptions for anybody. So I had to figure out, you know, when I'm in Ghana or in Oman, where it was pushing over 120 degrees, how am I gonna keep my insulin cold? And then when I'm in the Arctic Circle, how am I gonna keep it warm?
So in a way, diabetes in itself is an amazing race. And sort of it's a metaphor for yourself and for being an inspiration for others. Do you feel an additional responsibility now as being a community spokesperson?
I kind of do. You know, I get embarrassed when my blood sugar is high. And I'm like, oh no, I can't. Yeah. You know, I'm supposed to be sending out this message. But at the same time, as you know, your diabetes is its own animal. And you do what you can to control it. But there's going to be days where it just misbehaves. Yeah. And the more you can interact in the community, I think the more you learn, the more inspired you are.
Nat's knowledge and confidence would be put to the test on the last day of the competition.
For what portion can I have my eyes closed?
And Nat would need to overcome her biggest fear for the sake of the team.
That was probably the most terrifying moment of my entire life.
Go!
There seem to be a lot of us who want to challenge their bodies and want to challenge the limits that diabetes could place on you. So there must be a reason why we're doing this.
Probably. I mean, when you become diabetic, all of a sudden, everything you hear is almost bad news. It's like, oh no, not only are you have to watch what you eat and what you do, but you know, you have to worry about your eyes, your kidney, your heart, your nervous system, your feet, infection. You know, all of a sudden it's like negative, negative, negative. And then I think you just probably want to show to yourself and just feel that, no, I'm healthy. You know, I want to go live a healthy life and be active. Diabetes is a challenge. It's not a limitation. As long as you rise to meet that challenge and you put your best effort in, it's not going to limit you in any way.
Being diabetic is just a huge part of who I am. And I'm so grateful to have run the whole race. And it means the world to me to show people that have diabetes that you can be as active as you want.
That's the show for today. Thanks for tuning in. I know I learned a lot, and I want to know what you think. So be sure to share your thoughts in the comments below, and I'll see you here next Sunday, 7 p.m. Eastern, 4 p.m. Pacific, for another exciting episode of dLife TV Online.